The Selfish Gene, Chapter 2, by Richard Dawkins. The Replicators. In this chapter, Dawkins uses Darwin's theory to explain how simplicity can change into complexity. That is, how simple, unordered atoms can group themselves into complex patterns and end up as human beings. Dawkins states that Darwin's theory is the only feasible scientific explanation currently available and may explain how the process of evolution through natural selection contributed to the creation of a special molecule called the replicator. Darwin's survival of the fittest is a special case of what can be called the law of survival of the stables. The universe is populated by stable things. Stable things are collections of atoms that last long enough to be worth naming. Dawkins gives some examples such as rocks, galaxies, ocean waves as stable patterns of atoms, and hemoglobin molecules as more complex configurations. Complex atoms are being formed all over the universe since the Big Bang initiated the universe. The simplest example of natural selection is when random groups of atoms in the presence of energy falls into stable patterns, and it tends to stay that way. Unstable groups of atoms tend to be short-lived and therefore rejected through natural selection. However, this random process and slow building of molecules is not enough to explain the existence of humans. We can start by looking at the chemical conditions during the early days of Earth, before life began. We speculate that it is plausible that water, carbon dioxide, methane, and ammonia would have been present during the early days of Earth, as we know they are currently present in other planets in our solar system. Chemists that put these substances together and subject them to sources of energy, such as UV or electric sparks, in trying to artificially recreate primordial lightning, found that after a few weeks, a weak brown soup containing amino acids start to form. Previous to these experiments, amino acids were thought to be a sign of the presence of life. Similar experiments have yielded purine and pyrimidines, building blocks of the genetic molecule, DNA. This primeval soup would have been made around 3 to 4,000 million years ago, floating in the seas and formed large molecules. At some point, a special molecule called a replicator would have been formed by accident. Dawkins states that this replicator molecule was extraordinary, not because of its size or complexity, but because it could recreate copies of itself. The likelihood of this happening was very improbable, of course, if we consider the lifetime of human beings, but becomes more probable if we consider this across hundreds of millions of years. Dawkins argues that replicators can be thought of like a mould or template. As a mould, it would be a large molecule consisting of chains of building blocks that attracted other building blocks available in the primeval soup. The building block that are attached in this way would automatically arrange in a sequence that mimics that of the replicator and therefore create a copy. The other possibility is that each building block had an affinity, not for its own kind, but reciprocally for another kind. The replicator would then act like a template, not for an identical copy, but a kind of negative copy that would remake the exact copy of the original. We do not know if the original replicator was positive-negative, a template, or positive-positive, a mold. But modern replicators, the DNA, use positive-negative replication. The new replicator spread its copies rapidly through the sea and made other larger molecules more rare. With a large population of identical replicas, however, mistakes in the copying process will happen. Like copying books by hand before the invention of the printing press, first-generation mistakes usually do not distort the meaning. However, copying copies of copies then introduces errors that start to become more cumulative and serious. Although we do not know how accurately the original replicated molecules made their copies, modern DNA molecules show a high fidelity but sometimes still made mistakes. It is these mistakes that make evolution possible. Due to the errors, soon the primeval soup became filled with non-identical replicas, but some were descended from the same ancestors. We can assume some were more inherently stable than others and had better longevity. Replicators with the property of high longevity tended to become more numerous, and hence there would be an evolutionary trend towards replicators with greater longevity. Secondly, the speed of replication, known as fecundity, would also make replicators of one kind more numerous than others, and therefore replicators would trend towards higher fecundity. Thirdly, replicators with higher accuracy, known as copying fidelity, would be positively selected as well, given if the frequency of mistakes were too high, the replicators have a high chance of producing unstable children and therefore losing them. Dawkins states that this may be paradoxical because evolution relies on errors to evolve, but argues that nothing actually wants to evolve. Evolution is something that happens despite the efforts of replicators to prevent it from happening. So, if we were to take a sample of the primeval suit at two different times, say millions of years apart, there should be a larger proportion of varieties with higher longevity, fecundity, and copying fidelity in the later sample than the earlier one. Whether we call these original replicator molecules living things, Dawkins warns that words are only tools for our use, and whether they were living or not, we can assume they were the ancestors of life. As a primeval soup cannot infinitely produce replicated molecules due to finite resources, competition becomes an important factor in survival. Miscopying that created higher or greater stability or allowed a way to reduce the stability of rivals was automatically preserved and multiplied. For example, the ability to break up rival molecules would allow a molecule to obtain food and remove competing rivals. Other replicators found ways to protect themselves chemically or by building protective coats of physical protein walls around themselves. This may be how the first living cell was formed. Replicators that survived built survival machines for themselves to live in, which got bigger and more elaborate. The process was cumulative and progressive. After about 4,000 million years, replicators now live in huge colonies, safe inside large robotic machines, inside different species. The replicators created us, and self-preservation is the ultimate rationale for their existence. These replicators are called genes, and we, humans, animals, plants, bacteria, and viruses, are their survival machines.